impacts of global climate change are already being felt by many countries through the increasing occurrence and severity of natural disasters. For example, typhoons are hitting many countries harder and more often than ever before, dumping vast amounts of rain in short periods of time. In many countries, the increase in natural disasters is happening at the same time when large extents of agricultural land, forest, and natural environments are rapidly being paved over and converted into urban and industrial areas. These changes in land use patterns are compromising the natural system's ability to absorb these shocks. For example, rainwater is prevented from infiltrating the ground, and water runoff increases in these newly developed areas. When a big storm or typhoon hits, the result is massive flooding that puts people's lives and property in peril. Concerned local governments around the world are trying to address these devastating effects of climate change, but they do not know how to incorporate climate change adaptation and mitigation measures into their policies and plans in an integrated manner. And while land use decisions taken by communities upstream can heavily affect communities downstream within the same watershed, local governments rarely take coordinated land use decisions in order to avoid disasters. To solve these issues, experts from the Institute for Global Environmental Strategies and the University of the Philippines Los Baños proposed the Participatory Watershed Land Use Management Approach as an effective way for local governments to avoid disasters like floods and plan their development in a way that is sensitive and resilient to the changing climate. This approach is based on work done in collaboration with the four local governments of the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed in the Philippines. In this e-learning video course, the experts from IGES and the University of the Philippines will guide you through the four steps of the Participatory Watershed Land Use Management Approach, which are 1. Scenario analysis. 2. Risk assessment. 3. Climate change adaptation and mitigation countermeasures. And 4. Land use plan improvement. You will learn how local governments can use this approach to make their development efforts climate sensitive and reduce the impact of climate change by including appropriate countermeasures in their land use plans.
The first step of this approach is scenario analysis and aims to prepare a future scenario of land use in a watershed. To achieve this, a participatory mapping method is utilized to translate the development plans of the local governments into future land use maps. This step provides a useful tool to engage local officials in articulating their future land use and development plans into a spatial model. To initiate this activity, base maps of current land use patterns utilizing up-to-date satellite imagery of the watershed are printed on a large tarpaulin. Tracing paper outlining the political boundaries of the local governments are overlaid on this base map and provide the canvas for mapping the future development plans of each local government for the next decade. Government officials from each city in the watershed are asked to create hand-drawn maps depicting the proposed changes to this landscape over the next 10 years. The city officials identify the areas that will be converted into residential or industrial areas, as well as those that will remain as forested, agricultural, or grassland areas. After the participatory and land use mapping is completed, the hand-drawn maps are scanned, georeferenced, and mosaicked using geographic information systems computer software in order to integrate this information into the further steps of this approach, where it could be assessed in relation to its potential environmental, social, and economic impacts related both to these development activities and climate change. In the Philippines, the research team worked with the four local government units in the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed and facilitated local government officials from the planning environmental, and engineering offices of each city or municipality in this participatory and practical activity to visually map future developments.
The second step, risk assessment, aims to quantify the damage caused by severe floods by identifying the flooded areas as well as the population and infrastructure in these areas. So this step has two components. The first component incorporates land use data and population data in a geographic information system computer model. Land use and population maps are needed for modeling and estimating the potential impacts of natural hazards like floods. For example, a land use map can be used to estimate the amount of property damage caused by a flood, while a population map can be used to estimate the number of people within the flood-affected area. Land use maps are usually produced through the processing of remote sensing images. So these are images taken from satellites or aircraft. And to produce land use maps from these images, we process the images pixel by pixel, and then we assign pixels to land use classes based on the amount of light reflected at different electromagnetic wavelengths. For the project in the Philippines, we produced a present-day land use map by processing Landsat satellite imagery, which is a great source of images because it's freely available to the public and it has a relatively fine resolution. Each pixel in these images is 15 meters by 15 meters, so we can see objects on the ground that are around this size or larger. Using this imagery, we were able to generate a land use map at 15 meter resolution. So to understand the impacts of a natural disaster on the people living in this area, we also need fine-scale population data. In the Philippines, for example, the population data is available down to the barangay or the city district level. But what happens if only a part of a district is flooded? Ideally, we want to know where people are living within these districts. For this, we could get fine-scale population estimates by also incorporating the land use maps. By assigning the population counts from districts to just areas of residential land use, we could generate population maps at the same 15 meter resolution as our land use map. Additionally, since future population estimates are also available at the district level, this data could be incorporated with the future land use map from our participatory mapping exercise in step one, and we could generate future population maps as well to assess the future flood risk.
For the second component, step two, we need to assess the flood hazard in the watershed, both in the present and the future. We apply hydrological modeling for the current land use maps as well as the future land use maps created with the help of local government officials in step one. In modeling, we represent the real world system at a smaller scale. In the case of hydrological modeling, we simulate or mimic the hydrologic cycle, particularly the flow of streams and rivers and the surface runoff from a heavy rainfall or typhoon. In the case of the research project in the Philippines, since the city of Santa Rosa is prone to flooding, we used this model to measure the volume of the runoff from a given rainfall and show the flood extent and duration. So to do this, we used two freeware for the hydrological simulation, which is widely used by watershed modelers around the world. We used erosive rainfall and the watershed characteristics like terrain, land cover, tributaries, and soil characteristics as inputs for the simulation. After running the simulation, we then analyzed the results and conduct further calibration and validation. We visualized the result in two-dimensional and three-dimensional views using high-resolution terrain model. This makes it very easy to then identify the submerged or flooded areas. To finalize step two, we run the model under erosive rainfall with 10-year return period at two different land cover settings, the current land cover on the present-day land use map and the planned land cover on the 10-year future scenario map, to analyze the effect of land use change in the amount of the water discharge and its movement in the floodplains.
Step three of this approach consists of identifying climate change countermeasures. Considering the results of the risk assessment and the flood modeling simulation, local governments now have concrete information to plan for future land use and scientific information to better support climate-sensitive development. Using this approach, it becomes possible to identify effective policies and countermeasures for addressing both climate change mitigation and adaptation. These include a wide range of measures from structural measures, such as the construction of dikes and water storage, to non-structural measures relevant to land use policies, building codes, and ecosystem service enhancement. Some of the measures, such as the introduction of green spaces, green buildings, and reforestation, address adaptation and mitigation at the same time. Identifying effective countermeasures can also integrate non-climate benefits into land use planning in terms of disaster risk reduction, livelihood creation, and improved health. In the case of the project in the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed, the four participating local governments created a list of priority measures. Considering the necessity and feasibility of each countermeasure based on available data and information, one of the highest priority measures is zoning improvement, under which 7 specific effective actions have been identified. 1. Development controls are enforced in areas highly prone to flooding, which prevent settlement construction and maintain as much vegetation as possible. 2. Building codes are strengthened in high-risk areas to mandate measures such as the construction of flat walls and the introduction of elevated flooring to protect buildings against flooding. 3. Relocation plans for informal settlers who reside in flood-prone areas are devised. 4. Where forest or agricultural lands are converted to residential, industrial, or commercial areas, runoff mitigation measures such as water-permeable pavement and vegetated roofs must be taken. 5. River rehabilitation measures such as reforestation, river cleanup, dredging, and riverbank reinforcement are also implemented to increase water retention and drainage. 6. Actions for the strict enforcement of zoning ordinances are taken. And 7. Land use is harmonized among the local governments to manage the river basin as a whole, rather than individual cities separately, to address climate-related disasters such as downstream flooding by collective planning of upstream development. The improvement and strict enforcement of zoning through the above-mentioned management actions will alleviate the likely impact of climate change and contribute to greenhouse gas reduction. The preservation of existing vegetation and climate-sensitive development practiced with runoff mitigation measures will reduce rainfall runoff, leading to less intense and less frequent flooding. In the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed, the best-case scenario is that the runoff coefficient and flooded areas in 2025 will remain the same as those in 2014. As a result, the expected population affected by flooding in 2025 will be reduced by 20%, and the number of people in the flood-affected areas will be substantially lessened. Additionally, the exposure of these people to flood water damage may be further limited by restricting development and upgrading building standards in the flood-prone areas. Finally, if the current vegetation levels in the project area are preserved, then over 500,000 tons of CO2 emissions will be avoided.
Step 4 of this approach consists of mainstreaming climate change into local land use planning in order to make development plans climate sensitive. For any comprehensive development plan to be effective and sustainable, an integrated approach is necessary where all initiatives are linked and considered together. The approach discussed here can be mainstreamed and institutionalized through policies into the harmonization of the plans of the neighboring local government units with due consideration that management of an environment transcends political and jurisdictional boundaries. This approach will strengthen local government policies in protecting important natural resources within their jurisdiction. While the local government in the city of Santa Rosa has been concerned with addressing both climate change mitigation and adaptation, it has previously struggled to identify effective policies and actions that could be taken due to the lack of a strong evidence base and policy-relevant scientific information. The findings of this project have highlighted that the vast low-lying areas, including a large number of people and significant assets in Santa Rosa, would be heavily affected by flooding under a business-as-usual development scenario. The evidence provided by this project has led to the city government agreeing to mainstream the identified countermeasures in Santa Rosa's updated city land use plan. The city of Santa Rosa is located in the downstream area of Silang-Santa Rosa watershed, and flooding is a major concern faced by the city that creates significant social and economic impacts. It is now clear that an increasing susceptibility to flooding is due to the rapid change in landscape from forest and agricultural lands to industrial, commercial, and residential uses. Another major contributing factor to flooding in the city is the development activities taken by the neighboring towns, particularly in the upstream areas. This situation requires coordinated action across the watershed, and the integrated planning of all local government units within the watershed is essential. Building off the work initiated in this pilot project, the recently established Integrated Watershed Management Council for the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed was initiated through an agreement among the four local government units and the Laguna Lake Development Authority, and has legally laid down the framework for an ecosystem-based integrated approach to management and development in the area of the watershed.
As we saw in this video, it is possible for local governments around the world to minimize the impacts of climate change by implementing sound adaptation and mitigation measures into their development and land use plans. Scenario analysis and risk assessment are very useful tools to understand vulnerabilities, engage local government officials, and make them aware of the importance of appropriate land use planning for the safety of their citizens, infrastructure, and economy. In the Silang-Santa Rosa watershed of the Philippines, the work of the experts from the Institute for Global Environmental Strategies and the University of the Philippines Los Baños has resulted in the formation of a land use management council involving the cooperation of all four local governments. This provides an important step towards improving the safety of people and reducing the risks they are increasingly facing as a result of global climate change.